Bible prophecy is one of the most important things in the world today because the Bible reveals final signs that we're moving to the end of the age. Who wouldn't want to know what's going to happen in the future? But more than that, the Bible reveals who the key players will be, what they'll do, and how it will all end up. Today on The King Is Coming, our series on final signs continues with a close-up look at the key players in the final drama.
We're living in some of the most unusual days the world has ever known. Nearly every single day in the news, we are presented again with a new challenge of the threat of the times in which we live. Whether the problem is in North Korea or in Iran or in Iraq or in the Middle East or in Afghanistan, or whether it's in Africa or Europe or America or our own backyard, we obviously have to face the fact that mankind is running out of options to handle the seriousness of the problems that the world faces today. The global crisis is a reality of our times. And as we're studying what the Bible has to say about the final signs of the future, we want to take a look today at the key players in the final drama of the Bible, the most serious part of the scripture that unfolds the days leading up, ultimately, to the Battle of Armageddon itself. Now, I want to challenge you, take your Bible, if you will, today, and turn to Revelation chapters 12 and 13. There we have a list of the seven symbolic players in the great end times drama. As we understand who these players are, what significant role they'll have in the final days of world history, we can understand better where are we in relation to the ultimate plan and purpose of God Himself. Now, the Bible reminds us, just because you sense the end is near doesn't necessarily mean the end is here, that it's all going to end tomorrow. In fact, we believe that the world will not be plunged ultimately into Armageddon, to the final conflict, until a whole series of events must take place first. The Lord has to come back and rapture the church home to heaven, to the marriage, to the triumphal return at the end of the time of tribulation. And then during the time of tribulation, the seven symbolic players that are mentioned in the book of Revelation must all come to the forefront in a very unique way. Let's take a look at who they are, what they are, and what they mean to the future of the world itself. Notice Revelation chapter 12, beginning in verse 1, you have a woman, a very unique woman. There appeared a great wonder in heaven, a woman clothed with the sun and the moon under her feet, and upon her head a crown of 12 stars. Here, John, as he writes the Revelation, is using the symbolism from the book of Genesis, from Joseph's vision about his family, about the sun, the moon, and the stars. Every Jewish person reading this passage back in the first century would have understood immediately the woman is the symbol of the nation of Israel. And she, being with child, cried out, travailing in birth, pain to be delivered, etc. The woman is in turmoil, about to deliver a baby. Now, there has been great speculation throughout church history. Who is this? Some have said, well, this sounds like Mary, the mother of Jesus. Others have said, this is the church, because the woman ends up being persecuted and having to flee for her life, etc. But when we look at the entire Bible, it becomes obvious the woman here is the symbol of the nation and people of Israel, that Israel is, in essence, the mother of Christ. This is certainly not the church. The church is the bride of Christ. The woman here is the mother of Christ. He's the male child that is going to be delivered into the world, and Satan is going to attempt to destroy him. Now, in the book of Revelation, you have four women that play a unique role. Here in chapter 12, first of all, you have the persecuted woman who's the symbol of Israel. Then in chapter 17, you have the bloody harlot, the symbol of the false church. And then thirdly, you have the arrogant queen in Revelation chapter 18, the political system of the Antichrist himself. And then finally, in chapter 19, the fourth symbol is the pure bride, the true church, the bride of Christ. In this passage, in Revelation 12, this particular woman is not the bride, she's the mother. This is not the church, this is Israel. Jesus is a descendant of the line of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Jesus is a Jewish Savior who came to the Jewish people to offer himself as their king. But when the nation rejected him, then he said to the disciples, "Go into all the world and preach the gospel to all nations, calling all of them, Jews and Gentiles, to faith in me and in what I have accomplished for them on the cross." The message of the gospel is a message of the death, the burial, the resurrection of Christ, and it's a message designed to change the world. And as the church responds in faith to Christ, the true church, not a particular denomination, the true believers that know the Lord as their personal Savior, will one day be caught away in the rapture. But in the time of tribulation that follows, then the seven significant players come to the forefront. The first of those significant players is Israel. It has often been said, if you want to know where we are in the timetable of God, as we look at the final signs of the future, keep your eye on the nation and people of Israel. God dealt with Israel for the centuries of the Old Testament. Then, with the beginning of the church age, he turns his attention to the church. But after the rapture of the church, God's attention again will be focused on the nation and people of Israel. It is from among them that the two witnesses will arise. It's from among them that the 144,000 will go forth to proclaim the message of Christ in the time of tribulation. God has not abandoned his people Israel. God still has a plan and a purpose for them, but it will take the dramatic experience of the rapture to convince them that they have indeed been left behind and that they become the significant player in the end times drama, as the focus of biblical prophecy once again resides on the nation and people of Israel. But then we also read there's a red dragon, the symbol of Satan. There's a male child. There's Michael the archangel. There's a war in heaven. There is a crisis that is coming in the future of great eschatological proportions that has something serious to do with the future of the human race. What is it? What will happen? When will it happen? We'll come back in a moment and we'll see what the Bible says. The seven symbolic players in the great end times drama are clearly spelled out for us in Revelation chapters 12 and 13. We've already seen that the first symbol is the woman, the mother of Christ, the nation and people of Israel, that Jesus descends through the line of the Jews and comes to bring salvation to the world through them. Then we see the second symbol in verse 3. "Behold, there was another wonder in heaven, a great red dragon having seven heads and 10 horns," etc. He goes on to tell you in verse 9 that the dragon is the serpent, Satan, the devil. So there's no debate as to who the red dragon symbolizes in the book of Revelation. It's the symbol of Satan himself. He's the power behind the ungodly world system of the last days. In fact, Satan has been at war with God from the beginning of time, but that war will reach a climax during the time of the tribulation period. And then in verse 5, you have a third symbol, a male child. The woman brought forth a man-child, or technically in the Greek, a male child, who was to rule all nations with a rod of iron. But her child was caught up to God and to his throne. Bible commentators agree that this is a reference to Christ. Christ is the child that is born, who is the son of David, the son of promise, the promised Messiah, the Savior of the world. But in his ascension, he ascends back to heaven, to the throne of God in heaven. And Satan, because he cannot destroy the Messiah and he cannot destroy the raptured church, then turns his anger and his vitriolic attention against the nation and people of Israel in an attempt to destroy them, and pushes them to a very point of destruction where they finally call on Christ as Savior and as their Lord and their Messiah. And then the fourth symbol in the passage is Michael the archangel. We read in verse 7, "There was war in heaven, and Michael and his angels fought against the dragon. And the dragon and his angels fought, and they prevailed not, neither was place found for them any more in heaven, and they were cast out." Now, some people read this and say, well, didn't this happen back in eternity past when Satan fell the first time? And I think the answer to that is no. Satan fell from his position as Lucifer, as the covering cherub, as the shining one or whatever, back in eternity past, yes. But Satan still has access to the presence of God. In the book of Job, he still comes with the sons of God, the angels, to give a report to God himself and argues with God about why have you blessed Job so much. Satan still had access to heaven. In the book of Job, he had not yet been permanently kicked out. Notice what it says in verse 10. I heard a loud voice saying in heaven, now is come salvation and strength and the kingdom of our God and the power of his Christ, his Messiah. Why? For the accuser of our brethren is cast down, who accused them before our God day and night. Satan, throughout the centuries of church history, continues to go before the throne of God to accuse the brethren, the believers. He still loves to point an accusing finger and say, look at him, look what he did, look what she said. How in the world can you save them? How can they be a Christian? Come on, give me a break. Whatever, he's constantly accusing the people of God and the things of God and disturbing the whole stability of planet Earth. He's doing everything he can to fight against the things of God. And this passage says, this will go on for a long period of time. And then finally, God will say, enough, throw him out of here. Cast him to the earth. You say, well, Ed, how do you know that that's still going to happen in the future and that that's not what happened in the past? Well, because first of all, Satan still has access to the presence of God. Secondly, he's still the accuser of the brethren. He still wanders about seeking whom he may devour, etc. But it's very, very clear in verse 11 and 12. Therefore, you heavens, rejoice that dwell in them. Woe to the inhabitants of earth, the earth dwellers. Why? For the devil has come down to you, notice this, having great wrath because he knows that he has but a short time. Not a long time, not 21 centuries, not dozens and dozens of centuries of human history. He has a short period of time in which he does what? He's cast to the earth in verse 13, and he persecuted the woman that brought forth the male child. Now, to the woman there were given two wings like a great eagle that she might fly into the wilderness to escape into her place where she is nourished for how long? A time, one time, times, two times, and a half a time, three and a half times, or 3.5 years. That makes it clear that the final casting of Satan out of heaven to the planet, where he has no more access to the presence of God, is yet to occur in the future. And when it does, he only has 3.5 times left. It's obvious that if the tribulation period is 7 years in length, according to the book of Daniel, then this occurs at the middle of the tribulation period when Satan is cast out of heaven, cast to the earth, turns his persecution against the people and nation of Israel, against the woman, and drives her into the wilderness. And then verse 17 introduces us to the fifth symbol in the passage. It says, the dragon was angry with the woman and went to make war with the remnant of her seed who have the commandments of God and the testimony of Jesus Christ, the saved Jews of the tribulation period. So far we've got five symbols in chapter 12 alone. The woman who brings forth the Messiah is Israel. The Savior, the male child, is Christ himself. The dragon is Satan. The archangel is Michael, who stands up for the people of God. And the remnant of the seed of the woman are the believers that are persecuted during the time of the tribulation. But there are two more symbols yet to come in chapters 13. Two more symbols who will make all the difference in what's going to go wrong in the future: the Antichrist and the false prophet. My guest today is Dr. Mark Hitchcock, pastor of Faith Bible Church in Edmond, Oklahoma, and an adjunct professor at Dallas Theological Seminary. Mark, the Bible seems to predict in Ezekiel 38 and 39, ultimately a great war in the Middle East, and some of the players in that war are actually involved in the antagonism of what's happening in the Middle East today. Are we seeing the beginning of the setting of the stage for the fulfillment of that prophecy?
Well, I think we are. You know, it's amazing to me when you read the Bible, the prophet Ezekiel, about 2,600 years ago, prophesied some very specific geographical locations that would invade Israel in the latter years when Israel is living in a time of peace and security. which I believe will be then during that time of the tribulation when they've entered into that covenant with the Antichrist. But these nations are going to come into the land of Israel. One of them that's mentioned there that's very noteworthy today is Persia, which became Iran in 1935. And we see that Iran today is the key player over there in the Middle East. They're involved with arming Hamas in Gaza, Hezbollah up in southern Lebanon. In fact, they founded Hezbollah in the early 1980s. They're behind a lot of the trouble in Iraq with the radical Shiites there that are causing problems. So to me, the rise of Iran is one of the most significant events of the last couple of decades. That and the return and rise of Russia, or Rosh, that's mentioned in Ezekiel 38. There you have Rosh, or Russia, and you have Iran. These two nations that are mentioned in Ezekiel 38 forming strong alliances with one another, becoming the two dominant powers in that part of the world. And to me, this is just another evidence of the stage being set for the end times.
Yeah, a lot of people thought that when communism collapsed in Russia, that Russia would no longer be a serious problem for the Western world. And yet we find Russia turning more and more to the Middle East all the time and pulling away from America and the European Union nations and trying to form an alliance of some sort with the Iranians. Will that play into that passage about Magog and Persia, Iran, invading Israel at the time of the end?
Well, I believe it will. I mean, to me, it's incredible to see what's happening over there in Iran today. I mean, with their hatred for the nation of Israel, they're arming all the enemies. They're even trying to kind of go out and possibly overtake some of the other neighbors that they have. There's been a lot of talk about that, a lot of fear. A lot of those countries over there in the Middle East fear Iran more than they fear anyone else because they think Iran has imperialistic design to take over other nations there. So Iran is one of these key players that's there today, exactly as was predicted by the prophet Ezekiel 2,600 years ago. Who would have thought that, you know, 30, 40 years ago? But there they are today as the chief antagonist against Israel.
The Bible tells us very clearly that in the last days, there will be seven key players in the final end times drama. We've already seen five of them: the woman, the nation of Israel, the dragon, the symbol of Satan, the male child, the symbol of Christ, Michael, the archangel, and then the remnant of the woman's seed, the saved Jewish people of the tribulation period. But there are two more yet for us to look at: the beast and the false prophet. Take your Bible, if you will, and look at the 13th chapter of the book of Revelation. Chapter 13, verse 1 says, "I stood upon the sand of the sea, and I saw a beast rise up out of the sea." Throughout the book of Revelation, John uses the term the beast as the symbol of the Antichrist. Now, elsewhere in the Bible, he's called the man of sin, the son of perdition, the lawless one, the worthless shepherd, the abomination, etc. But we know him theologically as the Antichristos, the one who is against Christ, the beast himself. And as he describes him, he says of the beast that all that were on the earth, in verse 8, all of the earth dwellers shall worship him whose names were not written in the book of life. In other words, all of the unsaved of the tribulation period, all of those that do not come to faith in Christ, all of those that do not repent, whose names are not written in the book of life, will end up worshiping the beast, following the beast, and be deceived by the beast, that great end times ruler who is described in the Bible for his intelligence, his power, his persuasiveness, his political and social and economic control of the entire world. And then this same chapter introduces us to the seventh symbolic player in the end times drama, called the beast out of the earth, later called in the book of Revelation the false prophet. Look at verse 11 of chapter 13. "And I beheld another beast coming up out of the earth, and he had two horns like a lamb, but he spoke like a dragon. He looked religious, he looked harmless, but he sounded like the devil himself. And he exercised all the power of the first beast, and he caused all the earth and those that dwell therein to worship the first beast," the Antichrist. And then in verse 14, "he deceives them that dwell on the earth by the means of the miracles that he had power to do." And then in verse 16, "he caused all, both small and great, rich and poor, free and bond, to receive a mark in their right hand or in their forehead, and no one could buy or sell unless he had the mark of the beast, or the name of the beast, or the number of his name, and the number is 666. Now, many of you are familiar with that part of the prophecy, but let me remind you that what we have here in chapters 12 and 13 of the book of Revelation is an overview, if you will, a panorama of the major players in the great drama of the end times. If we want to understand where we are prophetically on the timetable of God, there are certain prophecies that are very obvious in the Bible. Israel must be back in the promised land in the end times, and they are. That there's to be a crisis in the Middle East, and there is. That there's an attempt of the Western powers to broker peace treaties with Israel and the Muslim world, and that's going on right now. That there is a revival of power in the European political system calling for a global government, a global economy, a global system, if you will, that all the world might fall under the control, ultimately, of one leader in the end times. Now, I'm convinced that we'll never know for sure who the Antichrist is until after the rapture of the church, after the restrainer has been removed. Then Satan will indwell someone to become the Antichrist. In fact, Satan himself doesn't know the time of the rapture of the church. Jesus said nobody knows that time, not even the angels. And Satan is a fallen angel. He doesn't know the date of the rapture. He can read the Bible. He can read the newspaper. He can sense things look bad. This looks ominous. I better get somebody ready to push him into position to be the leader in the end times. But Satan cannot indwell anybody until after the rapture of the church. Satan's hands are literally tied by the power of the sovereignty of God himself. God will determine when the end will come. God has set the time, not the devil, not anybody else. Now, the scripture says, yes, pray and work and try to hasten the time of the coming of Christ, etc., but Jesus made it clear, only the Father knows when that time is. The time is hidden in the heart of God himself, and God will determine when he wants to send the Son back to earth to get the bride to take her home to heaven. In the meantime, all we can do is look at the signs of the times and say to ourselves, these things are clearly predicted in the Bible. These are things that seem to be happening in our own day and age. They ought to tell us, if nothing else, the stage is being set for the second coming. Now, we have to be very careful. We don't want to make the Bible say more than it says, but we also don't want to make it say less than it says. We don't want to run ahead of God with wild speculation of our own, saying that this person or that person is the Antichrist, or this or that is a final fulfillment of prophecy, and this is the big one. No, we want to be cautious enough to let God be God. Let the Bible be true. Let the Scripture speak to our times. But when the Scripture tells us these are the things that you can expect in the future, and we look at the time in which we live, we want to be wise and discern the times, because surely we are moving rapidly toward the time of the end. Now, I want to urge you again and reassure you again. Bible prophecy is not written to scare us. It's written to prepare us. God told us what to expect in the future so that we would be wise and discerning about the times in which we live, and so that you and I might be prepared to meet the Lord when he comes. And he could come potentially at any time. If he could, then the real important question in Bible prophecy is he coming for you?
The tools that the Antichrist will use to bring the world under his control are already being prepared. In Cashless, a 224-page softcover book, Mark Hitchcock reveals how the stage is being set for a cashless society and the mark of the beast. In Shadow Government, a 232-page softcover book, Grant Jeffrey uncovers details of how a secret global elite is using surveillance to expose your deepest secrets and use them against you. In a special TV offer, we're making both books available to you for a gift of just $39 or more. Make your gift payable to The King Is Coming, Box 907, Colton, California, 92324. To use your credit card, call 800-622-2767 or go to thekingiscoming.com.
In 1 Corinthians 15, the Apostle Paul said, I've declared unto you the gospel that Jesus died for our sins according to the Scriptures, that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day according to the Scriptures. The message of the good news of the Bible is, you can't work your way to heaven. You can't pay for your own sins. You can't even change your own life. Some people say, well, Ed, one of these days I'm really going to get serious about God, and I'm going to make the kind of changes that are necessary to get me ready for heaven. The Bible reminds you, you and I can't do it by ourselves. The message of the gospel is Jesus did for you what you cannot do for yourself. He went to the cross and died for your sins. He took the punishment for your sins upon himself. He shed his blood for you. He rose from the dead for you. You can't do that. He alone can give you the gift of eternal life. And he simply calls on us to say, put your faith and trust in what I've done. Trust me for your eternal destiny. Call on me, and whoever does will be saved.